This old computer doesn't have any fancy color graphics. It doesn't have any color graphics at all. In fact, it doesn't even have grayscale graphics. The only thing this computer can show is black and white text, or rather black and green text. Oh yeah? So how do you explain this? Well, this video is about explaining just that, how to emulate graphics on a text display. The target screen is an 80 by 25 character display, and the character size is 8 by 8 pixels. The conversion of the image will be performed in three steps. The first is to remove the color information and rescale the image. The second is to remove the grayscales, as we can only show black and white. And the last step is to map the black and white pattern to the character set of the display. Step 1. Done. The rescaled image has a very odd aspect ratio when shown here, but that will be okay when displayed on the target screen. Step number 2. Now we need to remove all the intensity information and make every pixel either black or white. The easiest way of doing this is to make a histogram of the intensity levels, choose a threshold somewhere in the middle, make everything below that threshold black and everything above white. Now that's not a very good result, is it? It looks extremely overexposed and all the dynamics of the image has vanished. Isn't there a better way? Yes, there is. Let's say that we have a gradient like this and we want to emulate that by black and white pixels. To understand how we can do this, let's write down the values of the intensities of the gradient where 0 is black and 1 is white. On the next line, we write down the value of the approximation, again 0 for black and 1 for white pixels. We can now compute the intensity error that we do for each pixel. In this example, we shoot both over and under the intended intensity. An error of 0.2 means that we are 0.2 units too dark, and minus 0.8 means that we are 0.8 units too bright. Now the clever part is that we remember the total error that we have done so far by accumulating the individual pixel errors. We now use the accumulated error to decide whether a specific pixel should be black or white, instead of only using a specific pixel. When the accumulated error is larger than 0.5, it's time for a white pixel. By inserting a white pixel and thus overshoot the intensity, we also reduce the error. In the case of the first white pixel, the error was 0.6 before inserting the pixel and minus 0.2 after. Hence, we can insert several more black pixels before the next white pixel shows up. In this way, we can emulate the grayscale by spreading out the white and black pixel in the spatial domain, and the mix will be determined by the gray level in the gradient. We have effectively created a control loop that tries to keep the error bound to less than 0.5 for an entire image row. In other words, we propagate the error made previously into the decision for the next pixel. The code for this is very simple. If the accumulated error is larger than 0.5, then set the approximation to 1, otherwise 0. The approximation error is added to the accumulated error, and finally the image location is set to the approximate value. Let's see what happens when we apply this algorithm. Wow, that was quite an improvement. This grayscale emulation that we achieve by spreading out the black and white pixel, that actually works very well. The original image comes across quite nicely, given that we have restricted it to low resolution and black and white values only. The thresholding approach doesn't even come close to this. However, there are still some artifacts in the image that we might want to improve upon. Our algorithm works line by line, and if two lines have the same gradient, the black pixels will appear at the same locations, creating vertical stripes, or, as in this case, snake-like patterns across the image. Let's improve this further by propagate the error not only along the current line, but try to spread some of the error to the next line as well. But to which pixels should we spread the error? And how much to each pixel? There are many different possibilities here. Luckily, two guys figured this out already in the 70s, namely Robert Floyd and Louis Steinberg. They found out that one gets very nice results if a little less than half, 7/16 to be exact, should be pushed forward to the next pixel and the rest go to the line below. And among the pixels below, the 9/16, 3 will go to the back, 5 straight down, and only 1 forward. This approach is known as the Floyd-Steinberg-Dithering algorithm, and much can be said about its continued relevance today, but that will have to be another story. When applied, once again, wow, this looks fantastic. There is something really satisfying with this image. One can almost read the PET 600 label. When compared to the original image, we have removed more than 96% of the information in that image, but still it comes across very nicely. Let's go back to the three-step approach for a second. We have scaled it, converted it to a grayscale, and made it a black and white bitmap. But now it is unfortunately time to destroy all the nice dithering stuff that we have done so far, and that by mapping this to a character set. This is the image and the character set that we want to use. The character set comes from the very computer depicted, the Commodore PET 600 or Commodore PET 8296. The process is rather straightforward. We divide the image into 8x8 character cells, extract the bitmap, and look through the entire font to find the character that is most similar to it. We repeat this for all the cells in the image. This gives rise to another problem. How do we measure the similarity between two bitmaps? Say that we have two bitmaps, A and B, that each contain 64 pixels. We want the number of white pixels to be the same in both bitmaps. That would give rise to the same impression of spatial intensity or spatial grayness as we have discussed before. The difference between the white pixel count would indicate how different they are, so a measure of 64 minus this difference would be a measure of similarity. One example. Say that A has 33 white pixels and B has 16. Thus, A has 17 more white pixels than B, and the similarity score would be 64 minus 17, that is 47. That is 17 points below the ideal score of 64, where they have the same number of white pixels. Let's have a look at what this scoring system gives us. That's a horrible result. One can perhaps make out some major shades there, but the overall result is bad. I get the impression of a window at a rainy day for some reason. Clearly, this approach won't work. Maybe the problem is that we didn't care about the white pixel positions. For instance, these two characters score maximum similarity since they both have 32 white pixels. In reality, they could not be more different. Let's construct a different scoring system. Since each pixel is represented by a single bit, we can perform an XOR operation between the two bitmaps. By doing this, we will get the number of bits or pixels that are different between the two bitmaps. And this number will be the basis for our new similarity score. For example, if we have these two bitmaps, A and B, and we do the XOR operation, we get the difference in all the red pixels, which is 19 of them. This represents how many places these two bitmaps are different. The similarity score would then be 64 minus 19, or 45. A score of 64 would mean an exact match, and a score of 0 would mean that all pixels are different. Let's have a look at the result. Now we're talking. This is way, way better. We cannot even compare this to the old approach. It's still a bit clunky and noisy, but what can one do when one is limited to predefined 8x8 characters? The character set of the Commodore PET cannot be reprogrammed. It is what it is. But are we really limited to 8x8 characters? Let's try to do better. The Commodore PET has a 6545 video controller, and if one reads the data sheet carefully, one can see that there is a register that controls the number of displayed scan lines per character row. Let's try to use that to improve things a little bit further. That register gives us the opportunity to display only a part of the characters. It is always starting from the top, but one may end at any one line of our choosing. By reducing the number of scan lines per character row, one has to increase the number of character rows. So at 4 scan lines, the need has doubled from 25 to 50 character rows. There are some limitations on how many characters you can have, so one cannot really go below 4 scan lines. Let's have a look at the result when we use 6x8 characters. Now we see that the characters are chopped off at the bottom, and there is an improvement of the image quality, but it's not really apparent until one goes down to 4x8 characters. Now, I think we have pursued this track as far as we can. I don't think we can do much better than this. Let's just compare the three latest results. 4x8, 6x8, and 8x8. So now we have completed the three steps that were outlined in the beginning. But why didn't we skip step number 2 altogether? Step 2 only removes a lot of information. Couldn't we make a better approximation if we compared the character to the grayscale directly? Let's see what we can achieve with that approach. On the left hand side we have the grayscale character cell, and on the right we have the character that we want to compute the similarity score for. The red line represents the intensity level across the character cell for a selected line, and likewise the blue line represents the character at the same line. The green region represents the error that is made by approximating the grayscale with the character. It is the blue minus red. And as we have seen previously, some parts are positive and some parts are negative. We can construct the similarity score as some constant minus this error to get a larger score for characters that have small errors and vice versa. This scoring system generates a very surprising result. We end up with a completely black and white image. In fact, it is very similar to the thresholding approach that we saw previously. It is even an astonishing good approximation of the threshold result. But why does this happen? Especially as we have much more information now, and our current approach of measuring the difference is much more fine-grained than the XOR approach. So why don't we get an improvement? Why does it become worse rather than better? To understand the dynamics of this scoring system, let's look at an ordinary gradient and compare that to a half black and half white character. On the left hand side we have a negative error, and on the right we have a positive error. If the gradient has an average of 0.5, the positive and negative errors will be of equal size and cancel each other out. This makes this block style character a very good approximation to the gradient. Now, if we try to rearrange the black and white pixels to give the impression of spatial grayness, we could, for instance, place a black line here. However, that would cause the error to be dominated by negative terms, and that would result in a larger error in total. So this character would always lose to the previous one. The previous character is in fact close to optimal for all gradients with an average of 0.5. under the current scoring system. When this fact is combined with another circumstance, things start to clear up. All these characters are present in the font, plus some more of the same type. Together they provide near optimal values for the gradients with an average of 0, 1/8, 2/8, 3/8 and so on up to 8/8. And that for both horizontal and vertical gradients. These characters are highly competitive under the scoring system that we have designed. So let's revise the scoring system. Instead of computing the error based on the value of a single pixel, let's take into account a neighboring pixel to inject some degree of spatial awareness. With this approach, the value of the 2-pixel window is computed to be 1/2, as it contains 1 white and 1 black pixel. This places the entire blue line of 0.5 halfway between black and white, which is right in the middle of the gradient. If we now compare the resulting error for this checkerboard character with the error of the half black, half white character, we can see that this checkerboard character gets much smaller individual errors, which makes it competitive for gradients with an average of 0.5, or at least for weak gradients, that is, for the ones that do not change much from left to right. If this analysis is correct, this scoring system should select this character for large parts of the image. And what do you know? This is exactly what happens. Now we essentially got 3 intensity levels: white, black, and gray. It is interesting how this image has an early 80s ring to it when it comes to its graphical appearance. Some graphics artists use the checkerboard pattern to locally emulate grayscales. Let's put these two images side by side and show the size of the average region to the top right. Obviously, we need to find out what happens if we extend the average region to larger areas. With a 2x2 region, new gray levels appear. If we extend it to 3x3, we get even more levels to choose from when generating the image. This is all based on 8x8 characters. We can improve this further by reducing the cell size to 6x8, and as we expect, we get smoother shapes. A reduction down to 4x8 even further improves the impression. We could, in theory, improve this even more by increasing the average region to something larger than 3x3, but that will only give marginal improvements. We will be stuck with the 80s impression of the image, where we will have large regions with the same character. Why is that? Why does the same character win over large regions? Why isn't there some more variation across the slowly changing gradients? The reason is that we do not consider anything but the local 8x8 region, and every character decision is based on that information alone. So in some sense we repeat the same mistake over and over again in these regions. This shows the power of the feedback loop and the error propagation. That approach accumulates the errors and makes its decision based on all the errors made so far to keep the global error bounded. In this latter method, we may make an 1/8 or 1/16 error for every pixel, which on the image level adds up to a large global error. It is this error that shows up as the 80s style. The only way to fix this is to propagate the errors that is made in one character to other cells neighboring that. But that will have to be a story for some other time. So when comparing the two results, I would still pick the dithered approach to the left over the directly translated approach to the right, even though there is some nostalgic appeal to the image to the right. There is only one thing left to do now, and while I do that, I want to thank you for watching.